way. And then they saw us. We stepped out a little bit just for them to see us. They saw us. No aggression or anything. They did get a bit of a fright. Just turned, and the whole herd just turned and moved off. Thought I could smell something there. You can often smell buffalo or elephant too before you see them. But I don't think so. It doesn't look like anything is around here at the moment. And here's this waterhole up ahead. Let's just have a look here and see if there are any interesting tracks. But you can probably see where buffalo and elephant have been drinking. There are signs that these animals have been around here. You can see little elephant tracks. There's actually a hyena track which has slid into the water to drink. Have a look here. That's quite interesting. Look at that. That's a hyena track, and it stood on the edge and actually slid into the water or into the mud. Probably came to drink and then moved off again. So a lot of animals use these water holes. Right now, I think let us continue. We've still, like I said, we've got a long walk ahead of us. Let's head over to Tristan, who's still on Cheetah Plains, and see what he's got.
I am on Cheetah Plains indeed, and there's a beautiful butterfly that is right here. So, I don't know if you can see it there. Yeah, that is very spectacular, isn't that not? You can see it's just getting the nectar out of that little flower. Now, I'm just trying to see if it's the female diadem. It is. It is a diadem, so it's actually the male diadem that we're seeing there. You can see on the backside is black. On the underside, they often look like monarchs. And the female is a very, very close sort of coloration to the monarch, and does actually mimic the monarch because it wants to deter predators from eating it. Whereas the male on the top side of his wings is just black with a little bit of blue, but the bottom side is very monarch color-like, so that it also deters predators. And so when he's feeding and he's not actually agile and mobile and flying, it means that the predators see him as a monarch and therefore toxic, because the monarchs, at the end of the day, they sequester their toxin from a milkweed, and so when they're an adult butterfly, they're actually toxic. So you'll find that predators don't go after them. So mimicking them means that they get hunted far less than they would if they were just a generic coloration, and if their bottom side or the bottom wing matched the top side of their wings. So really, really cool. And I actually haven't seen a male diadem sit still like that for quite some time, so that was really nice. And beautiful colors. Did you see all those oranges and whites and blacks? So it's that typical aposomatic coloration. Now, aposomatic coloration, for those of you who are not sure what that means, it's basically coloration that deters predators. So it's blacks, reds, whites, greens, blues, and combinations of those that tell predators that I am toxic and do not eat me. So it's a very clever concept. It means that they also then don't get maimed or injured, even if they are toxic or foul tasting. If they didn't have those colors, a bird maybe would come down, grab them, bite them, and they would be injured. And so rather than having that situation, show very easily that they are brightly colored, and therefore the birds know, don't come and eat me, I'm toxic, and it's the end of it. But it is so beautiful on Cheetah Plains at this time of the day. I always love being here at the moment. It's so lush and green, and even though Djuma's had lots of rain, Cheetah Plains has really just had that much more. And the grass here is tall, and it's, like I say, it just feels like a different place. And in this afternoon light, when you get these sort of oranges coming through, it really is very, very pretty. And I'm looking forward to going onto the main open area, the big area known as Cheetah Plains, and where Cheetah Plains gets its name from, and just seeing the view and the vista from there with this orange light. So we're going to try and head there quite quickly, because the light is going to drop fairly rapidly. It's not going to be with us for too much longer, so I want to try get there as quick as possible. But it should be absolutely spectacular. Hopefully there will also be a beautiful pair of cheetahs sitting somewhere in a very spectacular fashion with the sun on them. That would be quite nice, maybe on a fallen over tree. What do you think, Vim? Fallen over tree or termite mound? Fallen over trees, scanning for impala that are going to be on the same area that they're going to hunt. That's what I reckon. So that's on VM's wish list and my wish list. Hopefully we'll see that. Lou, you want to see a kill as well. Okay. Oh, so Lou says she doesn't want to see a kill. She just wants to see the chase and see... Sharon, you wondering... what are male and female butterflies different in coloration, or are they the same? Well, it depends on the species. Some are very similar, but most of them, you'll find there'll be a slight coloration change between the male and the female. The males tend to be a lot brighter and more colorful than what the females do. In the diadem's case, like the one we just saw now, the female is also brightly colored, but she's got more orange and black to mimic the monarch butterfly, and they actually look almost identical. The only way that you can tell the difference is on the wings of a diadem. You won't find little black spots on the top side that the monarch has, and those spots are the only differentiation. Otherwise, they look exactly the same. But a lot of the butterflies, you'll find the male is a lot brighter colored than the female, and slightly different markings between the two of them. Another good example of that would be the African vagrant, which is a butterfly that we've seen quite a lot this summer. It's a big white butterfly, so we see it on hot days around the edges of the road, and that white butterfly, the male is like a creamy yellow color, and then the female is that white coloration. So most of them are different in color. Seems like the Ellies have been around here quite a bit. Lots of tree stumps and branches all over the road. Careful, little doves. Doves, I don't think, are the brightest birds as well. They're much like Franklins. They often like to land right in front of you as you are driving. So not the cleverest, and definitely cause a lot of drama for themselves, which is not ideal. So as we're carrying on going, we're going to try and get to Cheetah Plains as quick as possible so we can get that beautiful sunset. And while we do that, let's go across to Taylor and see what her plans are for the rest of this beautiful evening.
So earlier today we were actually chatting about possibly going across to Arathusa to see the lions. So we've now just gone past Treehouse Dam, checked there for any elephants. No elephants. So it is indeed a sign that we head across to Arathusa. We're just going to bumble along the fire break just parallel with Gowrie Main until we get towards Triple M Junction, and then I think we'll head down towards the airstrip, and the closer we get to that side we'll be able to pick up better radio connectivity, and then I'll be able to chat with the guards and find out if those lions are still there, and of course what the lineup is. But we've been really searching hard for elephants, and besides the mom and calf that we saw a little while ago, that's it, that's the only ones we've actually seen, which is a little bit sad. I was really hoping to get them swimming at Treehouse Dam, seeing as though that seems to be one of their favorite spots at the moment, but not this afternoon. Let's see it. Oh, this light is just so beautiful. Now, as we drive through this beautiful golden light with all the long grass sort of enclosing around us, Stephen, you're wondering, how do I think that these live wildlife drives help save wildlife? I think it's amazing because, firstly, we're touching out to people, more people, than what we would if we weren't doing a stream and sending it out to all over the world. And the second most important thing is the education that we are providing. So that is the key step into saving. Oh, warthogs. I just saw them. They were hiding in the grass. Hi, girlie. I'll get back to that. Now, there's a whole lot of them. I think they're going to go into this mound, perhaps. It's just on the left. Maybe they're getting ready to go back to sleep. Sorry, girl. She looks like an old girl. I think we've actually seen this warthog before. Just the shift of her tusk. That way she almost has a... Her eyes always seem to be a little bit closed, but they've now disappeared. Sorry, guys, I gave you a bit of a fright. Oh, that was nice. So sorry, Stephen, let me get back to what you were talking about. So I think education is the most important thing in trying to save and preserve wildlife, or with anything really, is people, if people understand why we need to do it and why it's so important, then if they were left in the dark, then they were really uncertain and they didn't know, and then they're probably going to not put much effort into it. So these drives that we do, and particularly with the schools as well, touching the youth of today, is the most important thing, because in the end they're going to be the ones that are really going to change the mindset of the world, is the young. So if we can push it into them now at a young age, saying how important it is to protect the planet that we live on, because at this rate we're just destroying it and there won't be a planet left if we carry on the way that we're behaving at the moment. So get it into those kids' heads, protect all these areas, protect our wildlife in particular, because without certain species you know, bees and termites and ants and things like that start to go extinct, we're going to have a real problem on our hands. It's obviously very sad that we're losing things like pangolin or armadillos and elephants and lions and leopards and, you know, you name it. But it actually goes down to some of the smaller creatures too. Without them, there'll be very little pollination of plants going along, and that's vitally important. Of course, the more plants we have, the more oxygen that is being produced. So I think education, and I think that's exactly what we do here. People can ask us any questions they like that's relevant to what we do, not only just about the animals, but conservation questions too. And we can all sort of just comment on what we think. So yeah, so that's it. That's how I say with regards to poaching as well, everything. Education. Tell people why we shouldn't be doing it and what we can do instead. And I think that's the best way to approach something like this, is not just harp on the negatives all the time, but perhaps come with your negatives and then also give a solution and as to why you think that maybe something like this can work. Even if it is just going to change a small thing, any change out here in the wild, with anything that's got to do with wild, will be a big change in with the ripple effect. So yeah, that's what I think. Well, I don't know, maybe you agree, maybe you disagree, maybe you've got some other views, and if you do, why you think it is so important, of course you're welcome to let us know. Hang on, what do we have here? No, sorry, monkey footprints. And you can hashtag Safari Live, of course. And we love conservation questions. It's something that we don't often speak about. We don't talk about enough, I don't think. So maybe we should start chatting about different things, ways to preserve wildlife. So yeah, so right, let's change the Game Drive channel now. There's the radio. Let me see if I can get hold of anyone. Afternoon mobiles, can anybody copy me? It's Taylor from Wild Earth. Right, I'm going to try and get hold of some guides now. It may take me a couple of attempts to try and get hold of them. So let's send you across to Tristan, who is looking at a gorgeous sunset.
I am, but we're also showing off VM's incredible camera skills, following a flock of red-billed quellias that are busy flying around in the open here. Look at them go, and you see they all move together as a grouping, and so it makes it much harder for predators to get them. But there's this beautiful sunset that we were admiring. Isn't that spectacular? Now, Cheetah Plains is a really great place to be able to watch the sunset. Now, we're not on the main plain area itself, we're here at Cheetah Plain Pan, but it is still just spectacular to see, and to see that orange just dipping and then all those other colors that are starting to come out. It really is a beautiful evening. The temperature is absolutely perfect as well. Very, very nice. Now, no sign of any cats yet or any sort of tracks for the Cheetah brothers. Been looking around, but nothing just yet. So I just want to go around and just check and make 100% sure that they are not sitting on the main open area, which is their favorite place to lie. They do sometimes lie here at Cheetah Plain Pan, and they sometimes lie a little bit further north of us on in Coral. Yeah, and what's that bird over there? You see in the tree there, that's... Is it a cuckoo? Let's see. Is it not a Burchell's Coucal? It is. There we go, a Burchell's Coucal. Now, this is a very cool bird. It's one of the bio-indicators of rain out here. So if you hear this bird calling, it's liquid bubbly call, which I will play for you shortly. So Lou is saying this might be the first Burchell's Coucal we've seen this summer, which is crazy. I mean, they normally are quite common, but I suppose we just haven't had the same amount of vegetation we normally have. And this one is sitting in a complete random place. I would never expect a Burchell's Coucal here. It's completely open, right in the middle of the plain. So very, very strange. Now I'm going to play its call for you so that you can hear what it sounds like. Right, so that call, when you hear that call, then you know that rain is coming, and it's very accurate. Most of the time, I've actually, to be honest, never noticed them fail. I've always heard them calling, and true as Bob, there are the rains in a few days' time. So really cool to see They're one of my favorite birds out here. And you do get one other species of Coucal that has been seen in the Sabi Sands, but we won't see it here. It's unfortunately, Coucals, most of them like wet riverine areas. So you'll find them on the Sand River and the Sabi River quite a lot. And on both of those rivers, you'll get a very, sometimes, and it's rare to see them, a black Coucal, which is a beautiful bird. So let me show you what that looks like, because I'm dying to see one here in the Sabi Sands. And so far, I unfortunately haven't seen one, but let's have a look. There it is. Isn't that spectacular? So we have this one that has that white chest that we were seeing now. And then this is the black Coucal, which has got that black coloration there. So I'm hoping that one day we'll get spoilt and we'll be able to see it. Unfortunately, we would need a bit of more water to be flowing through some of the rivers, maybe like the Mulawati, for us to be able to see one of those. But we can live in hope, and you never know. I never would have thought that I would have seen a golden pipit in the Sabi Sands. So you've got to just kind of dream big and hopefully things will happen. VM, can you see tracks there? Do you see what those are? Sorry, I just see footprints. So I don't know if it's for an antelope. Oldish. So VM's saying it looks like an oldish lion track. It's very difficult because it's all blown and not very clear at all. I'm just trying to think when the last time I drove here was. It's a few days ago. I actually didn't drive here when we saw the cheetah yesterday morning, so it could have been, and I did have tracks for male lion yesterday morning, so it could be from then. Maybe that's when it was, VM, that male from yesterday came this way and crossed out. So I just want to check here. Ooh, these are so destroyed by wind and other animals that it's actually really tough to see what these are. There is a hyena track in here, but we've got not very much space to maneuver, so tough. But yes, there is a lion track there, VM. Well seen. But it's going the opposite way and not very fresh at all. The hyena tracks are on top, so those are male lion tracks from the day before. But given that we don't have very much light, that's why I'm not focusing too much on those lion tracks right now, because I just want to get to the plains, because if the two cheetah brothers are around, then we're going to not have too much light to view them. So I want to just try and see if they are there, and if there is a chance that we give ourselves as much time as possible with them. Now I believe Taylor's got a sunset that she says is better than ours, so let's go across and see who wins the contest.
Well, I didn't say it was better than yours, Tristan. That was Louise, who has seen both of them, who has mentioned that. And it has just disappeared. We've literally just lost the sun. It went down very, very quickly this evening. So it's not quite as impressive as, well, it's still going to get that way. So maybe we'll find a better spot as to where we should go and park. At the moment, you can see it's now completely fizzled out. But we are indeed on Arathusa. And I must tell you the update. So I inquired about the Leon sighting, which is just off of the Arathusa airstrip, and they offered me a standby number 8. So I think everybody is doing a lion day, and that's often the problem with afternoon safaris, is because guests will arrive during the middle of their day, and the first safari that they go on is normally the afternoon one. And what a way it would be to, of course, start your day, if it's your first time in Africa, to see the wild animals, is to go off and watch lions. And we know that that pair has been mating, so to see something like that is quite special. So I'm actually not surprised to the fact that it is quite a busy sighting. But we'll keep our ears open. If those standbys start to drop quite, or come through quickly, then maybe we'll get an opportunity to head over there a little bit later. But remember, we've also got infrared. We can stay out a bit later that side, so most of the guides will probably head through and have a sundowner at some point too. But it is getting darker now, and I'm sure that Byron is heading back towards quarantine and the fading light, so let's go across to him and have a look at his sunset.
I have indeed, Taylor, and the sun has just dropped behind the mountain range from where we are. It's dropped beyond the horizon. Still a beautiful color in the sky at the moment. We are on quarantine. We're going to start losing light quite quickly, I think. But there is something I would like to show you quickly before we go. Joshua, I believe you were asking about a termite mound, and you said you would like to see a termite mound. Now, I can't find an active one, but I have found a rather large termite mound to show you. Now have a look at this. Now this entire structure behind me is a termite mound with a tree growing out of it. Now what's happened here is this is no longer an active termite mound, but the soil of the termite mound is very, very fertile, and once the termites have moved off, a lot of seeds get brought into the mound, obviously by the termites and also by animals that sit on the mounds, like monkeys and baboons. They'll drop seeds and those seeds germinate very quickly on termite mounds like this because the soil, as I mentioned, is so fertile. The reason why it is so fertile is because the termites build it with a mixture of their feces, the soil and their saliva. And that mixture together forms this sandy substrate which they're able to build together and build the termite mound. Now that is exactly what's happened here. Very fertile termite mound, and this tree is growing out of it. A lot of vegetation, no longer active. There are no termite mounds, no termites inside this mound. You might get other animals using it, like snakes and possibly mongoose and so on, but they won't disturb a tree that is growing out of it. So it's wonderful to see a termite mound like this. This morning we saw one very active. We saw the big holes, open holes. We could see the termites inside, and we could feel the temperature radiating out of the termite mound. Very, very warm and moist air coming out of the mound. But this one, obviously, no longer active. But it just shows you how big they can get. Now, I'm just trying to think. One this size is possibly 40, 50 years old, probably more, maybe even more. It's hard to gauge. I always struggle with gauging how old a termite mound is. I don't know how accurate we actually are, but one like this is very, very old, if not more, probably closer to 80 years, I'd say. Anyway, great to see you. And there we go, Joshua, a nice big termite mound for you. But don't forget, keep joining us, because we might try and find you an active one. There are always active termite mounds around, and those are very interesting to see, especially when you get to see the little termites and how they operate around the mound. The soldier termites protect it. The worker termites will go and get food and bring it to the mound. So there's always something going on. I'm trying to scan the area now to see if perhaps the wildebeest or the impala or anything have returned onto the clearings for the night. I don't see anything just yet. They're possibly just down in front of us, maybe. I'm not sure. Let's head back to Tristan quickly for an update, and I'll see if I can't find some any animals before it gets dark.
Well, hopefully Byron will be successful, because we haven't been too successful in finding our cheetah brothers before it gets dark. So no sign of them on the open area. There is actually no sign of anything, really. There was one wildebeest, which is Brent's favorite wildebeest, Gnomnus Gnomon the Gnu, which is a mouthful to say the least, and is why Brent named him like that, is so that it was difficult for other people to say his name. And like I say, unfortunately none of them around. So, well, it's just one of them, and no cheetah around, or even lions. I was hoping maybe we'd find a Birmingham boy lying in the long grass. Would have been quite pretty, but alas. So now our next mission is we're going to try and see if we can make it another caracal this week. Oh, don't fly away, little button quail. So there's the little button quails that everybody's been asking about. Now, I know Byron had one yesterday. Oh, it was a fleeting glimpse, but we did get a glimpse nonetheless of the little button quail. So they're really jumping into the grass, and once they're in the grass, there's no ways. You can see how little that is and how well camouflaged it is. So really very, very tough to see, but at least we got a little glimpse. It's better than nothing. Normally we don't see them at all, so quite happy with that. Now, like I say, we're going to try and see if we can maybe pull a rabbit out the hat and get this caracal for the second time this week. That would be quite nice. Now, I've never seen a caracal in the Sabi Sands, so I'm itching to see one, and I'm very jealous that Taylor got to see one. So we're going to go and drive in that same area. It's now the time of day where it's good to see these kind of cats, these smaller cats that start coming out at this time. So hopefully we'll be lucky and maybe we'll get to see it. It'll be really nice if we do. I'll be over the moon. I don't actually know if I'll even be able to speak if I see one. It'll be amazing. So I'm hoping that it will be around. There's lots of tracks on the road here, but it all looks like hyenas. The hyenas seem to have been quite busy. But none of them are very fresh. It's all from the last few days. You can see actually where Taylor drove last night. She's driven over the top of some of these, so not very fresh tracks at all. But otherwise, Cheetah Plains has been very quiet. It's been not even the same normal kind of bird life that we see. I suppose we did get you a little bit late for the birds. It's now at that time that most of the birds are already finding their roosting sites or back at their nests to be able to settle down for the evening and get out of the way of some of the nocturnal predators. And also because they don't fly very well at night, their eyesight is not good at night. It's like us as people. We tend to do much better during the day, and it's the same with most of the birds. The only ones that do better are the owls and the nightjars and the coursers. The coursers have been fantastic recently. We've seen so many of them. This is definitely the most coursers that I've seen in the summer this year. There's been hundreds of them. You can't really drive a road at the moment without bumping into one at night. So it's been good to see them. The only surprise is that we've only been seeing the bronze-wing courser. We haven't been able to see the Temminck's courser, which would have been quite nice. Now, I didn't catch the name there, Lou. I'm sorry. It's a little bit of static. Bill Tan, you're asking whether animals see in the same way we do in terms of color. Well, some do, some don't. So the cats, particularly lion and leopard, which have sacrificed their color vision to be able to see at night better, they don't see very well at all. They almost see in monochrome shades, so blacks and whites and grays. They don't see very much color at all. And the reason for that is because in our eyes we have two types of cells. We have rods and cones. Now, rods are light cells, so those are ones that pick up light and are able to then bring us and process the light in for us to see better. And the cones provide all the color. Now, in a human, it's pretty much 50-50 between those, and we're able to then see a very vast spectrum of color, as well as being able to see very well during the day, but at night we're absolutely useless, we can't see at all. Whereas the cats have very, very few cones in their eyes. They have only rods, and so the rods then mean that they can see like we do during the day at night. So their color vision is sacrificed for that, and it's the reason for it is that they don't need to see in color as well. They know what an antelope looks like, so it doesn't matter what color the antelope is. As long as they can see the antelope, then they can hunt it. The animals that do see very well in color are animals that generally feed off certain types of vegetation. So monkeys will see very well so that they're able to eat ripe fruits. Elephants have a somewhat good semblance of color vision in their sight. Most of the antelope species is not as good as ours, and they don't see as the same spectrum, but they do see in color. So it just depends on the animal and the role that they play within the environment that will dictate what their eyesight is like and what sort of spectrum of color that they can see. But there's very few that can see in the same spectrum that we do as humans. I'm just checking all the trees as well, just to see. You never know, maybe Vatumi, which is Inkanyeni's cub, or Inkanyeni, or Kachava, these are all leopards of Cheetah Plains, might be lurking. So I'm just checking all these trees just to make sure. There's some beautiful marulas here, so just making sure they're not perched in one of them as we go. Now, it is getting very dark. We had a look at the beautiful sun setting with Taylor and myself, and that means that it's time for Byron to start getting home so that he can be nice and safe and not get trampled in the dark. As we were talking about, we don't have very good color vision, I mean night vision. So let's go ahead and go across to Byron so that he can say his goodbye and get home safely.
Thank you, Tristan. I'm so glad you care about me. We have found some animals walking onto the clearing. Just two young male Nyala behind me. And there they go. There's a nice termite mound that one is walking past. Very exposed termite mound. Possibly still active. There's no vegetation growing on that one. I'm sure later on we'll start seeing the impala and the wildebeest coming back onto the clearing too. It's very peaceful now this time of the evening. It is lovely. Nice to see those Nyala just walking past. They're always very relaxed antelope. it's nice to get close to them. Often you find them, especially in this area, you find them around the camps a lot. They come in and feed on the green vegetation and move on. Kazit, you want to know what is the purpose of a termite mound? Now, for one thing, the termites play a huge role in an ecosystem. So what the termites do is they feed on and break down the material, plant material, dead and decaying plant material around an area. So it is very, very important that they do break down their plant material. Otherwise, the place would be littered with dead plant material and branches from trees and so on. So they break everything down. The termite mound itself, the purpose of that is to protect the termites. They've got a place to live, and also there's a very intricate system. What happens is that the termite mound allows these termites to regulate a temperature which is suitable for them to live in. It also allows them to lay eggs, which are then incubated within the termite mound. There's a queen that lays the eggs. She'll lay a few thousand eggs a day. The workers pack those eggs in certain parts of the termite mound in incubation shelves, and they are incubated. Then once they hatch, those termites then become part of the colony. So basically it's a home to protect the termites, this very hard outer structure, so that it's difficult for animals to get to them. But we do know there are animals like the aardvark, a pangolin, that specialize in feeding on termites. So they'll break open the mound, they'll dig a hole to get to those termites. They're very rich in protein and it's very good for their diet. But that is the main reason for the termite mound. Let's see if there isn't anything else around, perhaps. A termite mound can be rather deep. In fact, especially, I'd say, the one that we saw earlier, that very large one, that can get probably 2 or 3 meters deep. Now, I know some studies have been done where they found termite mounds much deeper than that. And the reason for that is obviously they excavate all the soil out to build the mound above them, but also the termites need moisture. So they get that from groundwater. So as long as there's a good water table, the termites are able to get moisture from the ground. So that is also why they need to go deep. But they can go 2, 3, 4 meters deep, which is very, very deep. And it all depends, obviously, on the size of the termite mound. All right, so we're not too far from camp now. It's been a great walk, very exciting with those elephant and buffalo on foot. We've seen some interesting little creatures too. So from Craig on camera, and of course Herbert, who was out with us too, from myself, Byron, thank you very much, everyone. I think we earned a beverage or two. So let's head back to Tristan, and we'll see you all tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Yes, I'm Tristan, and I've just shaved my beard and I've grown a very long ponytail and also dyed my hair now. Very nice. Of course, I'm not Tristan. My name is Taylor, and on camera again with me, just in case you have only just joined us, is Jandre. And we are coming down to the last hour of safari now. It's actually getting dark quite quickly. Luckily, the time change is not too far away. Jandre and I were actually just speaking about it, how... it's amazing now we almost have a complete hour of darkness. The sun is long gone and the last of the light is really just about to disappear. So we'll put spotlights on probably in the next 5 to 10 minutes or so. I think we could put them on. And I've been listening to the radio that lion sighting is still very much full. So I don't know if we're going to get in there this evening, but like I said, I'm going to keep listening out. So we're just bumbling to see if we can spot anything else. There doesn't appear to be, by the sounds of it, any other sightings on Arathusa at the moment. That's okay. Maybe we find something that has been missed. It also makes sense as to why the lion sighting is so full. Have a look here. Some very old lion tracks. And the... It'd be nice if Shadow would pop out, though. The only thing, though, I don't want Shadow to pop out right now because we wouldn't be able to view her if she had her cub. T- Tormented Zombie Owl. I had to turn the volume up there just to make sure that I was getting your name correct. Now, you're wondering if we've ever had any bats on camera. Jean-Dre, you've been here much longer than I have. Have you ever put a bat on screen? Many times. Should we try this evening? Well, if we find some bats, we'll definitely try. I was actually talking about that last night, about not having seen too many bats. It's so difficult, though. We don't often... we'll see them because they're flying around above our heads, of course, and we just hear them, and then, yeah, like Louise says, it shouldn't be a challenge. That must be a very difficult thing because bats have a very erratic flight pattern as well. So we'll see what we can do. Like I said, I'd love to have a spot where we just build a thatch roof specifically for the bats to live under, and then we have a permanent sighting of them. That would be very nice. Let's see what else is around here. It's very quiet. I actually haven't really even seen any impala. I don't think we've seen any animals since we've been here. Oh, well, I have found is a bird in the fading light just over there. Hello. And look how beautiful this European roller is. Actually, you know what we can do? Can someone help me out here? I know a few of you love to take your screenshots of birds. Can you please find a photo of a European roller when they first started arriving, so a few months back, and compare that image with the image that we're looking, well, with the bird that we're looking at right now. So take a screenshot of this beautiful one, and off it goes. And then perhaps you can make a little collage and share it with all of us by hashtagging Safari Live, just so that you can see the difference in coloration from when those birds have traveled a very far distance coming from Europe or the Middle East or Asia, coming all the way down here to South Africa. You won't believe it. When they first arrived, like I always describe it, is it looks like they've been through the washing machine quite a few times. Their colors very faded. They almost just look exhausted. But now that they've built up enough fat reserves, they're looking good, colors all bright again. It won't be too long before they start their long journey home. Right, lots of mud wallows here, and seem to have been lots of things laying in them throughout the day, probably buffalo. Let's see if we can have some lights. Oh, not quite light worthy just yet. We'll get there though. Right. It's amazing how some days are just so full of animals, and then other days either we're just not driving in the right spots, or they're just being very much secretive and hiding away all the time. Listen, male hoisted a large male warthog. Was that with Jamie? Who was that with? Was that? I can't even remember who it was with. I remember that sighting. Very envious of it. There's nothing quite like a big male leopard taking something that can weigh more than it up to the tops of a tree. Was it with Brent? Ah, it was with Brent. Okay, very nice. Very, very cool. Maybe one day. I suppose I can't have all the luck though. I can't be seeing caracal and having spectacular sightings of lions, and then also to have great leopard sightings. But maybe after this long-awaited break from the leopards, we'll eventually get a goodie. Although I've had a great leopard sighting with Karula, but that wasn't live, that was all fair. That was well into the evening when I'd watched her kill an impala. That was really cool. Ah, that's really cool. So Jana is just saying that there was once a stack of the Anderson male and Tingana, and that must have been quite impressive too. Now, Jeff, you're wondering if I ever get lost and how long does it take to find my way around. I think I'm the only one that gets lost everywhere. But when you say lost sort of to me, oh, Jen, sorry, not Jeff. And there's a couple of impala, but you'll see they're very nervous of us now just because it's a bit dark for them. So sorry, Jen. Yes, I get lost all the time. I think I'm the queen of getting lost, but like I said, it's not lost that, oh my goodness, panicking that I can't find my way home. It's quite easy actually navigating on these reserves. You just got to know where north, south, east and west is, which direction the lodge is, and then of course know your boundaries. But even then, if you get lost and you do accidentally traverse on someone else's property, you always just say, sorry, please can you point me in the right direction so that I can go home. It's the most uncomfortable feeling. A couple of times I've ended up on all sorts of properties where you just sort of go whoops and do a U-turn and try get back to where you were. The most lost I've ever been was when I first started guiding. Your first property is always the hardest to navigate on. And yes, I got severely lost. I had to have someone come out and fetch me and guide me back home again. But other than that, it's not so bad. Luckily for us, we have a GPS on the cars, so Louise or whoever's directing the show can say, Taylor, you know, that's actually not our traverse anymore. You've got to come back east or west or south or north, something along those lines. And then I've got one on my phone too. The only one we don't have for is Chitwa. I've got a piece of paper, hand-drawn map. But I don't actually think I really use it anymore. I just drive around. I've got my favorite route that I like to use that I often see quite a number of different animals on. Right, let's see what else we've got. I'm trying to think. But you can get lost. I mean, you hear stories, and you know who gets lost the most on these reserves? It's actually quite funny, but I'll tell you that story in a moment because it's a long story. We'll have a chat about it. Tristan, on the other hand, has picked up some vultures who are doing a bit of nesting.
We have indeed. It's quite incredible because what you've got is you see there's a small little bird that's flittering about on the bottom left there. Now that's a red-billed buffalo weaver, which is actually the bird that is built that entire nest area that you see. So that is not the vulture's work. That is from the buffalo weavers. They've constructed that. There's multiple different pairs that have built that nest together, and it's basically like an apartment block. Each one has got its own individual sort of area that they nest and builds and goes together. And the vultures are repurposing it for their own use by the looks of it. So they've decided that they're going to use the top of the buffalo weaver's nest for their own chicks, which is fine because the buffalo weavers ultimately are in no way threatened by the vultures. They are not going to be hunted by the vultures, so they won't mind too much. In fact, it will actually keep a lot of danger away. You'll find that snakes and things will be taken care of, so the buffalo weavers are probably quite happy about that. Now, the interesting thing is that it's this time of the year now where the vultures are going to start prepping the nests for the winter. They actually lay their eggs in winter. Sometimes it'll be around June, July area, and they'll lay their eggs, and the eggs are in the nest for, I think it's about 45 days, I must just check, 45 or 48, I always forget the number. And they then incubate them for that amount of time, which is a long period. And obviously it is a big bird, so that's why the incubation is much longer. Once they have hatched, then those chicks will be nest bound for about 190 days. So that's why they breed in the winter months, so that by the time the summer comes, those little chicks are already fledging and are able to move around. And also the thing with these guys is that ultimately they don't have to tie in with the summer like some of the sort of insect eaters. There's always going to be carcasses around that they can scavenge, so they can provide food in the winter and the summer, which is really cool. But it's just so nice to see them silhouetted against this beautiful sky in the background there. Look at the oranges. It really is very, very pretty. But we're going to leave them. I don't want to chase them off. Don't want them to fly away and move. We want them to be able to develop their nest a little bit further, and it'll be really cool to follow this and carry on seeing what goes on. Hopefully what we can get is a situation where every time we come past we'll see some more development on the nest itself, and then following that we'll start to see the chick being born, and then you see this little white fluffy chick on top, and then the adult flying back and forth, and you slowly watch the progress of this white chick getting bigger and bigger and bigger. Now they can lay more than one egg. They do lay two eggs, but what you'll find is that often there is siblicide, so one will kill the other one in competition for food. In fact, it happens all the time. I thought I saw something here. Is there an insect on there, Viam? Can you see there? So on this little pole here, sorry, let me just turn off. So there we go, it's a assassin bug. Look at that. That's very cool. So normally we see these guys on bushwalk, but I was just driving past and just noticed the coloration as we were driving. So you can see that these guys have got that long proboscis. Sorry, that was my hat in the way. I'm just trying to position myself so that I don't get in the way of what's going on. And that little assassin beetle will be looking for any insects that it could potentially hunt. So that's quite cool. Nice. It's not always about the big things when you're out here. It's always good to have an eye out for these smaller things that are next to the road. You can really kind of spot some really incredible stuff when you're looking a little bit closer. And you know, at night we can get so focused on finding the nocturnal cats like leopard and lion, and you know, the caracal that we were talking about earlier, and we can sometimes forget about all the little things that are around us. So the little insects that come out and the spiders that start to work magic. The other night we had such an incredible sighting with spotting along, and there was just hundreds of spiders moving along the web. It was absolutely incredible. It was the first time I've ever seen. So, you know, it's good to look deeper at times. Myron, all the way from Durban, so here in South Africa, you're wondering whether vultures have a breeding season. Well, it depends on the vulture. So these white-backed vultures, in my experience, they've always bred in the winter months. So they start their breeding in the winter, and then by the summer, the chick is fledged and flying around. Things like hooded vulture, they tend to actually breed a little bit later. So they normally breeding around September, August, September, October. White-headed vultures, to be honest with you, have absolutely no idea when they breed. I'll try and do some research on them. They're also so rare these days. We actually don't have any leopard-faced nests anywhere near here, nor do we have white-headed. We need two nests in this particular area for the 100%. So I would be lying, I guess, but I'll try and find out. And if you're watching this time tomorrow, or if you're going to watch in the morning, the leopard faced and the white headed. We also get the Cape vulture very, very seldom here, but I know that they also build nests normally in the winter months. So if you go into Marikele National Park in the northwest area, there's big colonies of Cape vultures there, and they're able to start breeding in the winter months already. So it is like that. Oh, that is a welcome sound. So that sound is a woodland kingfisher. Now I'm hoping it's not flown off. I want to try and roll back a little bit and see if it's here. I don't know if we'll see it, unfortunately, because of the light that we have, but let's just see. Now I haven't heard the woodland kingfishers at all, so most of them have started to leave now. They've started to go back, didn't it? Oh well, it's okay. It's a bit dark. I don't want to actually blind the kingfisher either, so we won't do that. It is actually a very spectacular view from here as well. We've got this beautiful tree coming over this sunset. So that was where I thought the kingfisher was, but it's unfortunately not there. So this is a beautiful apple leaf that we have here, and then it's sort of casting this eye into this beautiful sunset that we have there. You can see the last sort of yellows and oranges of the day before the darkness starts to close in and it becomes nighttime and things start to change. And those woodland kingfishers, funny enough, are always the last to call of the diurnal birds and the first ones in the morning. So at 4:30 in the morning is when you start to hear them calling. The only other one that is calling more than they are at the moment is the monotonous larks. And funny enough, today on Cheetah Plains, which is where we first heard the monotonous larks, I didn't hear one monotonous lark while we were driving around there today. So I wonder if they're starting to go away. I said the 10th of April. VM said tomorrow, which was, so we'll see. Yeah, maybe you're going to be right. I actually haven't noticed them nearly as much today, so it'll be interesting to see how quickly they then depart. Maybe it'll be as quick as they arrived. Right, so we're going to go through a little bad signal area here. It's always a little dodgy as we go through a little riverbed. So while we do that, let's go across to Taylor and see if she's gotten lost or if she's managed to find Anderson yet.
Done either just yet, but something we are doing is drainage system, which is quite nice. So if anything, we should really have some luck down here. This is a great spot for leopards, and John Doe was saying he's seen moving down here. Right, sorry about that. Watch your head there, Jean-Ré. Obviously, of course, being in this drainage system, we're going to try and move out of it as soon as we can. We haven't got too much further to go, but there's plenty of gremlins around here. And if you don't know what gremlins are, it's just, well, a name that we give to the every now and then the tech problems that we get. Remember, we are broadcasting live from South Africa right now. I'll tell you exactly what the time is. It is 21 minutes past 6 o'clock in the evening. So sometimes these things do happen, but we make up for it by, well, of course, showing you wonderful animals. And hopefully, we'll have something to show you. Another thing we could see down here, potentially is a Varroa eagle owl. This is a very nice area, and I haven't seen a Varroa eagle owl for quite some time. I think Brent saw one a few weeks back, which was quite nice on his last call. So that's something that we used to see actually on a... Is that a light? It is a light, eh? Now, I don't know if there's a sighting here or if there's another guide here. Let me try and get onto the game drive radio. Do you know this road, Jandre? Let me... I do. I'm... Perfect. I don't want to check here. Oh, it could be further away. Let me just find out quickly on the radio. I'm just checking my GPS. Oh, which mobile is Junction Mofofonyan Red Dam? Just want to see. Maybe they're having a sundowner. Maybe there's a sighting. They have a bird or something. So we don't want to just go barging in there and return here so the bugs don't come and get us. There could be a number of different things. And that's one of the reasons why we do have a radio. Is we've obviously got to be courteous of the other guides. Now, they've just started up their cars now, so I don't know if there was a sighting. But we'll let's carry on going forward too. And I don't think I've actually got radio comms down here. So we'll just have to apologize if we do bump somebody's sighting. But always good, just to give them the benefit of the doubt, maybe wait a little bit. It could have been a guest actually using the luxury facilities, you never know. Oi, down we go. Let's see which way they're going. I'll pull off for them. Please don't be any big stumps. Yes, there's no stumps yet, so we're just going to let them go past us quickly. Wonderful. Everybody enjoying their afternoon safari, of course. Hello, Sean. How are you?
Delicious, and how are you?
Are you delicious? Sean has just told me that he's delicious. I've never heard anybody describe themselves like that. Wonderful. We are at live at the moment.
Hey.
I thought that maybe you'd had something just around the corner. Ah, perfect. Sean is the chameleon king this evening. Right, cool. Cheers, guys. Bye. There we go. That's exciting. So that's what he was looking at. So let's see. Oh, no, now the pressure's on. I feel like I shouldn't have told you that because now there's pressure for me to try and find this chameleon. Let's see if we can do as good of a job. Now, it's always fun trying to find chameleons. Now, he was just around the corner here. Is it on this guari bush? Or is it here? We've got to look, so Jean-André, keep your eyes peeled. Let's check, is that it? No, that's not it. This will be very embarrassing if I can't find it. It could be coming from a different angle, though. Now, you see if I think... Did he say by the pump house, so a little bit further up? I thought we saw him here. Okay, well, let's keep going. Perhaps it is by the pump house. If not, we'll just have to find our own chameleon. Let's check. Scanning all these bush willows, all the guari trees. There's so many different trees out here in this drainage system. So I apologize for not looking back. I want to keep my eyes peeled and make sure that we do find it. Let's go out of 4x4. That's a leaf. Oh, I think there it is. Yes, we got it. Woohoo! Whew. I was getting very nervous that we weren't going to see this chameleon, of course. But there it sits beautifully. Wonderful. Well, that was an easy find. That wasn't actually too difficult at all. And the chameleon looking around, just keeping a careful eye on us. Well, keeping one eye on us. The other one is not too bothered by us. It's on the other side looking for other things. And that's what's so amazing by chameleons is that they are indeed able, it will to move them independently like that. This is a beautiful shot. Look at it go. Very busy. Looking down, looking up, looking towards us. And it's important that they're able to move their eyes around like that. And I think that lions and leopards wish they could do something like that, but more so, and maybe the prey species, so like zebra and elephants and all those things, I'm sure that they wish that they can do that with their eyes. This way and be able to spot predators a lot easier. And well, for the chameleon, not only is it watching over its back, it's also looking for things to eat. And there's plenty of moths, plenty of grasshoppers, all sorts of goodies out and about at the moment. That's a lovely coloration that we've got at the moment, don't you think? think there's a spider web at the back. I can see that, well, all we're covered in spider webs at the moment. Isn't this cool? What a lovely little chameleon. Holding on for dear life, making sure that it does not fall off. Not using its tail this evening, though. That's just curled up and on the side. But when they do walk, it's one of my favorite things to watch. I love how they have their tails uncurled, just in case they need to loop it around and hold on. I wonder if chameleons do the sort of same strategy that I've seen caterpillars doing when they are spotted by something, or if we try to pick one up, the first thing that they do is they completely let go of the leaf that they're walking on and drop towards the ground. And that's a good plan, because they fall into the long grass and then it's a little bit more difficult for whatever was trying to eat them to try and find them again. And I wonder if chameleons do something like that. Because I think for anything that predominantly lives in a tree, and you're not too far up, if you're quite low down to the ground like this one is, you can see all the grass blades touching it, it wouldn't cause too much damage if it were to just fall off, or not jump off, I suppose, if something were to snatch it up. But luckily for them, there isn't too many things out here that would eat a chameleon at night. Now, Lara, you've said that chameleons have the original grumpy face. I think you're quite correct. Grumpy cat has got absolutely nothing on the look of a chameleon. And I think that another contender for the grumpiest expression that we see out here has to be that of a wet southern yellow-billed hornbill. The way that they fluff their feathers up and almost retract their head into their shoulders or into their wings, just to try and keep a bit warm, that facial expression is hilarious. And that's one of my favorite things to do, is when it is rainy weather, often the bigger game is not always out, but the birds are always perched in trees looking miserable. And I love finding the most disgusted looking birds. Their facial expressions are quite funny. And one day I need to do a collage or something of, or even you can do that. That's another thing that you could do. Remember I asked you earlier for the lilac-breasted roller, not the lilac-breasted roller, the European roller, to do a before and after picture of what they look like when they first arrive to how lovely they're looking at the moment. It's nice to do that with the birds too. Now, Costa, you're wondering if anything eats chameleons. Many things, but at night I'm just trying to think specifically if there's anything that really eats a chameleon. And I'm sure a jackal, if it came across a chameleon, would probably gobble that up. But during the day, I think a chameleon has a lot more predators. So something that I've seen seem to be masters at catching chameleons during the day are actually southern ground hornbills. They often poke their beaks into shrubs and they pull one out. I think I've seen southern ground hornbills eating more chameleons than I have seen them eating anything else, between that and grasshoppers. But snakes, I often see lots of snakes crawling around in trees. They're really good, of course, at catching chameleons, and they are nocturnal snakes, so there's a potential predator. And then birds of prey, so from a Wahlberg's eagle right through to a tawny eagle wouldn't say no to a little snack like this. So there are many, many different things that will feed on chameleons. But at night, I think they've got a chance. An owl, I don't think, would eat a chameleon. We were actually chatting about this last night. So I think they're relatively safe. Just watch out for the jackals. And a young lion and a young leopard. Because they like to eat everything, especially when mom is not around. They don't really have a choice. And they've got to resort to eating things that wouldn't potentially be as tasty. Chameleon, I think we're going to leave you and to enjoy the rest of your evening in peace without having to listen to me ramble on all the time. Let's go to Redderm. Thank you, James Richard. So Louise has just said, who's directing the show, that you've sent a great comparison picture of the European road. Having a look a little bit later when we're back on safari, or if I pick up some signal, what I might do is maybe we'll all have a look at it together. But down here in these drainage systems, unfortunately, I haven't got any signal at all. Right, that was nice, a little chameleon. Like I said, I'm relieved that we managed to find it. That would have been very, very embarrassing. Okay, I'm going to go towards, I think we're going towards Red, no, we're not going towards Red Dam, it was the left one, hey, right, we'd have to turn around now. So here we go, Jen, here's me going the wrong way, but luckily I can just turn around, of course. And this is, nope, that's not the one I'm looking for. Yes, put the back light on, and the spotlight, and then I have to reverse now because it is so thick and I don't really have a spot to turn around, but that's okay. My reversing's not too bad. Quite wee. That was, of course, not my bad driving. That's just because it's a very tall antenna. Am I going all the way down? Oh, here. Ah, thanks, Jandre. I'm terrible with driving around down this end of the reserve. Whee! Who knows? Maybe we're going to find a hippopotamus at Red Dam. Almost there. Just a couple of little bumps. Let's just take it easy. Check very carefully here because Shadow does like it around this spot. But again, if we do find Shadow and she does have her cub, unfortunately we're not going to be able to bother them too much. Even though we have the infrared, that cub is still quite young, I think, to bother with a car bounding around. Huh. Let's have a little scan here. Right, let's have a very quick scan. We'll do across the light beam. Doesn't actually look like there's anything in this dam. Unfortunately, we've missed the hippopotamus. But Tristan is back in range again, and he's found himself some night elephants.
Well, listen to this before I start talking. Isn't this incredible? Now, if you were in the bush for the first time, you would probably think that this is a pride of lions, but this is indeed a herd of elephants, and they are vocalizing quite a bit. I'm not sure what's upsetting them. There's one here of them, if you want to try your IR light. There we go. So if you didn't believe me, there they are. Now, you might notice that the picture is a little bit different, and that's because we've got our IRs on. We do not have one little bit of light at all coming off the car, so that is just completely in infrared, and it allows us to view these elephants without any worry whatsoever. You can see the elephants are not disturbed by the light. Had we had a light and shone it on that elephant, we would have had a situation where the elephant probably would have shied away and moved away, whereas now, with the infrared light, they're not picking it up at all. Much like us, we don't see it at all, and they're just happily feeding around us. Now, I'm interested to know what's going on with these ellies, because elephants will often give birth at night, and there is a lot of vocalizing, and sometimes it can mean that the ellies are maybe going to give birth. So I want to just try to go forward. It's a long shot and a really big statement to make, but there's generally very few things that make ellies vocalize as much as these guys are, other than either a newborn calf or a big male that's in amongst the herd. Now, it's quite difficult to actually see at the moment, so I'm just going to use my spotlight just so I can scan. I don't want to bump into a very angry elephant either. Can you see them, Vim? They're somewhere here. They're in the thickets here now. I wonder. Let's just go forward a little bit. There they are there. Yeah, maybe we can get a good visual from here. Let's go back onto it. I'm going to use the IR light again just to see. So you can see them moving around. Oh, there we go. That's the cause of the problem. Look at the size of that male. Massive male. That's in amongst the herd, that's irritating this female. Now that is a really, really large male. Isn't this spectacular? To be able to watch this and know that we're not influencing them and be able to spend time with elephants at night is really quite something. And to listen to these sounds, sorry Lou, I didn't catch the name. The elephants are making quite a bit of noise. But you said that one of our viewers has said that if you didn't know better. Bree. Bree, sorry. Sorry, Bree. It's the elephants are making quite a bit of a racket. And I'm trying to just keep my sort of watch around us because I don't want an elephant to just rock up next to us and be right on top of us. But you said if you didn't know any better, you would think it was dinosaurs. And indeed. So when they did the movie Jurassic Park, they used elephant vocalizing as a lot of the sounds for the dinosaurs. So a lot of the sounds in Jurassic Park were gleaned from elephant sounds. They just remaster them and mix them with other sounds to get that. Now look at the size difference between these two elephants. That is the big male who's in must. You can see he's dribbling from his temporal glands, and his legs at the back are very dark on the inside, so he's in full must. And that is a tiny little baby which basically fits underneath him, which is crazy. And there comes the female. Now I reckon that's the female that's in heat, because that's the one that's been making a lot of noise and the one that he followed into this thicket. This is absolutely incredible. You can see it's still quite a warm evening, so quite a bit of ear flapping just to cool the bodies down. But where did he go? Now I want to watch this big male because I don't want him come barreling through the bush at me. But look at his reach. Look how high he's reaching with his trunk. Now that tree is, I can't even tell you how high that is. I mean, that is a very long way up. And that elephant bull is still able to reach that. Absolutely amazing, and he's got a beautiful set of tusks as well. Very, very, very cool. So a lot of you are commenting on the high-tech IR equipment and how impressive it is to be able to do this. And to tell you, it is seriously impressive. So just being out here and being able to watch this, because generally for us, if we had come across elephants at night, we would be putting all our lights off and just moving out of the area, not being able to actually watch a lot of what they get up to at night. So it's really so incredible to be sitting here watching a herd of elephants in the pitch darkness and be able to listen and observe behavior. It really is quite something. Did you see how that elephant bull just broke that branch? That branch is a very thick branch, so to be able to pull that down is quite something. Here, the elephants are all around us. It is absolutely incredible. It is such an interesting atmosphere to be in amongst a herd of elephants at night. It's completely different to during the day because you can't really see what's going on, and especially with the IR lights on. So you just kind of trust your instincts and use your ears more than anything else to hear what's going on, and it really is quite special. Fiam, will you just shine close to me here? I just want to see if there's not one that's creeping up on us. No, that's okay. Laura, that's a very interesting question. You want to know if the elephants are more vocal at night than during the day? Well, no, it depends on the situation. So if in a case like this where you've got a big bull in amongst them, that's what's causing this ruckus. This is what's causing all the problems. So that's why they're so full of nonsense. Generally, they're actually not that vocal at night. They're more vocal during the day. And elephants, funny enough, a lot of the sound that we can hear, we don't normally pick up because, the sound that we can hear is normally only when there's some sort of an issue. So if there's a threat that they're chasing or a big male like this, so we don't really hear them that much, actually. And mostly what we hear from elephants is breaking of branches and eating of vegetation. The sounds that they make to communicate a lot of the time is at a frequency way lower than what our ears can pick up. And so, who knows, maybe at night they do communicate more than during the day. It's possible, but we don't hear that as much. And in terms of this vocalizing that we're hearing now, this is very, very special. And you don't hear it more in the day or in the night. It's very random. And it's all just because of this bull. And if you look at the size of that little Ellie, look at the size of its trunk in comparison to the tusk size of that male. Its trunk thickness is the same thickness as that tusk. And that elephant is already probably, I would say, maybe 8-9 years old. So that male is absolutely massive. Now, for those of you who want to take a screenshot, I'll try come back to this very same tree and I'll stand exactly where that elephant is, and then we'll get a better idea of just how tall he is and how high he reached to be able to break that branch. You can see where it's broken, so I will come here and stand at the bottom and we'll try and get a visual of size comparison, but I'll have to do it tomorrow when there's no ellies, because otherwise I will be flattened if I try that now. Those elephants will not take kindly to me being there. But wasn't that absolutely incredible? Amazing. So we're going to carry on. So, Sharon, you're asking a tusker in must. Is he any sort of danger, or is he in any harm? Is what I got out of that. I'm sorry, Louisa, you broke up a little bit, so that's all I heard. I just want to go back a little bit. There we go. So any danger to a herd itself, or any harm to a herd? Well, he's not really. I mean, he's not going to attack any of the females or any of the young ones to like something like a male lion would, but he's a big animal and he's very pushy, and he's going to come close to the little babies and the females, and he's going to cause a lot of problems amongst the herd, and they actually just don't want the attention. So he's big and he's cumbersome and he's irritating, and so that's what it's all about. It's actually not that he's going to attack any of these females or these young ones. He's going to be rather fine with them, actually. He's not really going to cause an issue, but it's more that he's just a nuisance than anything else. Can't find any of their little babies or anything like that, so we've only just got the male. Now that's with the light on, so I'll turn the light off. That's what we see without the infrared. Isn't that amazing? And then look at that, absolutely incredible. So to be able to see into the dark like this is really very, very, very cool. It's an amazing piece of technology, this. But that is a massive elephant. I'm quite keen to see this guy during the day, just to see how big he actually is. And like I say, he's got some beautiful tusks there as well. Nice, big, long, thick tusks. And he seems to be an absolute gentleman. Even after all this panic and chaos and vocalizing that we've heard, he hasn't in any way been aggressive towards us, even though he's in must. So even though the vehicle's been moving up and down, he hasn't worried about us at all. I'm just going to sit for a few minutes just to listen to him feeding off these branches, because it's quite something to hear him going through these thick branches and crunching down the food that he's eating. Isn't that incredible? Just to sit and listen to the sounds of them feeding. Susan, you're asking if I didn't catch the detector, I caught the Ellie sounds. Shanson, bat detector. Bat detector, okay, got it. Thank you very much, Lou. Sorry, it's a little bit broken up. But a bat detector will pick up any sounds of the elephants? Well, I would imagine it would. If they are making sounds at that frequency, then the bat detector might pick it up. I've never actually seen anybody use a bat detector to study elephant sound. They generally use other pieces of equipment, but it would be possible, I would imagine. I don't know. I'll try and see if I can research it. I know in the past I've used one of those bat detectors here in Sabi Sands, and we didn't pick up any other sounds other than the bats. So that's the only thing that we were able to pick up, but it's potentially could work. I don't know. I would have to come and sit in an area like this with a herd of elephants and test it to see if it would pick them up, but I'm not sure, to be honest. We'll have to try and get one and see if we can. And it actually would be a really cool piece of equipment to have here, because while we're sitting here and we've been listening to the elephants and we can hear a few insects around us, there is so much chatter going on with the bats. It's absolutely incredible to know how much they vocalize at night that we don't even know about. It really is very, very special. And so when we did it in the Sabi Sands, I was absolutely shocked at all the chatter that was going on around us at the time. Now we're going to just slink away from these elephants now and leave them in peace. But wasn't that the most special thing? Right, so I believe Miss McCurdy has made her way back to Djuma. She's Andersonless and hasn't found him, but maybe she'll be lucky and find something else. So let's go across and see how she's doing.
I will be so excited, Tristan, if I could see a leopard right now, and I'm sure that everybody watching would be just as excited too. Now, we haven't really seen much at all. I don't know where all the animals are tonight. I think, if anything, this must be from the last two evenings that we've had, which have been filled with all sorts of animals, has been a little bit of a quiet one. Let's see, maybe we pick up on our hyena. We're on Philemon's cut line now, and this is close to where Ribbon's den is. So we won't go to the den now because we don't want to spotlight the hyena cubs, but you have to come out this way. So we'll see if we've got any fresh tracks. We're almost there now. We'll check on the road to see if she has come out, and then maybe we'll do a couple of loops around quarantine. That sort of seems to be the first place that the hyenas go to, is have a look around there. Or also, I changed my mind, let's go on Ingwe Alley and have a look around those pans. Now, it's just an impala. Impala, I don't want to blind you. Let me just dim my lights. Bye, impala. Oh, there's actually an entire herd just moving off into the thicket. Right. Lights on again. Continue searching. Maybe we find some more chameleons in the very famous Philemon's Dip. That should be called Chameleon Road. There's always so many. And tonight's a nice warm night, so we should see more than one. I'll be disappointed. I wouldn't be disappointed, but I'd be surprised if we don't see more chameleons this evening. But we do have a bronze-winged courser sitting on the road. Hello, birdie. Catch a scorpion for us, please. Aren't they beautiful? They are such striking birds. Standing dead still. Not sure whether to fly away or not. So at the moment, it's just exhibiting the perfect sort of freeze technique that most animals will do when they are frightened. And off it goes. It decided to flee this time. Good choice, bronze-winged courser. Much more intelligent than the doves that Tristan almost drove over earlier today. I think on game drive you have at least about 5 or 6 moments where you think you're going to drive over a bird, just because you're going so slowly and they don't want to move. Now, this is where... Nope. Spotlight. My spotlight is now just being a bit silly. It doesn't look like she's come out yet. I can't see any fresh hyena tracks. I can see some buffalo tracks, though. Okay, let's go around. It seems maybe she's not ready to come out just yet. But we'll go and check around this area anyway. Always a little bumpy here. Actually, every time we've ever spotted hyenas the last few days, it always seems to be just here as we go through Philemon's Dip before you get to Ingwe Alley. And we followed what I thought could have been Ribbon the other evening. She went down that way. So surely it must be a favorite route of theirs if they're constantly spotting them in that area. Nothing in the dip. Okay, let's go up here. Now, Alicia, you're wondering about the bats, and you've said, aren't we going to try and spot some? We definitely are. I haven't even heard them yet. I haven't heard the high-pitched noise that the microchiroptera, the insect-eating bats, will use. But I'm still waiting. But bats, we can still chat about bats, I suppose. Bats, I think, must be some of the most efficient feeders out there. I think we worked it out when we were in the tent that the bat can eat something silly like 1,000 mosquitoes in an hour, and they're feeding for most of the night too. Normally that initial crepuscular period, I think I've seen a chameleon, but it could also be a moth or a butterfly. Let's go back and have a look. Can you see what I'm looking at? You can straight away, you can see it's a bright white reflection. I think it is a butterfly. No! What is that? It's bird poop on leaf. How disappointing. How's that for a white reflection? Ah, sorry. So that white little smudge there was a bit of a disruption. Sorry about that. It was bird feces on a leaf. So nothing exciting, unfortunately. Definitely not a chameleon. Louise says she thought it was a frog. Almost. Not quite. Could be a foam nest frog. They also reflect that color. Let's try. Come on. This is such a good road normally. This is my go-to road. Ooh. Let's see here. Come on, animal. Also, at one point we were seeing the leopards around here, so who knows when they may make a return. Nothing at the dead. Little pan. But you just got to keep searching. Keep your hopes up. I can't wait to see a white-tailed oh no, elephants. I've forgotten. Look at this roadblock. Who thinks I can move that with a car? No, I'm just joking. We're not going to try. But yes, it's an entire silver clusterly that the elephants have kindly uprooted for us. And we're only going to start to see more and more of that, especially as it gets drier. So we'll just have to do the scenic route. And then that tree will actually have to be removed. Oh, watch the aerial, huh? That will have to be removed with a chainsaw. That will need to be cut up. And there we go. Now we need to just get back to the road without driving over a log. Very quiet. Come on, chameleons. This is the perfect spot. Many branches, much trees with lots of foliage on them to hide away. Not this evening. Not this evening, unfortunately. Ah, that was a very lucky bronze-winged courser. You almost got driven over. Oh, wait, there was a feather. Oh, Shelley, you are so wonderful. Thank you. So yesterday, I was actually talking about that we should mention our highlight of the drive every night. And I completely forgot about it. See, this is why I need to rely on you, because my brain doesn't work very well. I think it needs to go in for repairs, or hopefully in Australia. Maybe you can have brain transplant by now. Who knows? Those Australians always coming up with wonderful things. Don't think that that's a thing. But if it was, I probably wouldn't get one anyway. I like my ditzy brain. So sorry, Shelley, as I digressed there quite severely. You're wondering what the tip of my the highlight of my day. The chameleon was quite nice. I'm just trying to remember everything that we saw. The elephants were good too. Chandra, what was your highlight of the drive? I know we didn't have anything like spectacular. Well, not yet. We could still see something. I don't know. It was a tough one tonight, Shelley. I think I'm going to have to go with the chameleon. I think the chameleon was probably my favorite thing so far about this evening. But let's see if we can top that. We will only settle for the best, of course. So if it could be a bird catching a scorpion or something. Ah, I have an idea. There's a... What is that? A common dacre or a bushbuck? I'm not sure. But should we put the infrared on? Right, we're going to put the infrared on in three... Oh, no, it's on. Ah, oh, Chandra, you beat me to the countdown. No. It just shows you're more quick on the ball than I am. But there we go, a little common dacre. Just hiding away in the long grass. It looks like a female. She doesn't have any horns on the top of her head. And look how much more relaxed she is as we've switched off. Let me turn the other light off as well. All the lights. As we've switched off all the lights, she doesn't want to bolt, which is normally what they do. She's actually so comfortable, she's ruminating at the moment. Isn't that lovely? To not have to watch the rear end of a dacre as it disappears off into the thicket, which is normally the sighting that we get to see. But again, if you have just tuned in, we have just switched over to infrared now. So the animals aren't able to, well, this light doesn't bother them. We can't see anything. It's pitch black. And even though it looks like I am putting a light on her because her eyes are illuminated, that's just the tapetum flash that you're seeing that a lot of these animals have in their eyes. And often what that does is that membrane at the back, it just reflects light that is being absorbed by the eye back into the eye so that the rods can utilize it and it can help them see a little bit better. And I think if anything, this must sort of be what the animals must see. Sort of these dull colors at night, not really seeing too much detail like what we see during the day. And I'm sure it'll be something similar. Not that I'm saying that they do see in IR. Oh my goodness, is it time to say goodbye already? I can't believe it. This drive has absolutely flown past. But I think we're going to, well, I hope you've enjoyed it. Actually, I've changed my mind now. Shelley, this is the highlight. We're going to stay in infrared. I like that common dacre. That was great to see and to, of course, watch in infrared. But for myself and Jandre, it's been wonderful. And we'll catch you tomorrow on the Sunrise Safari. Let's go across to Tristan.
Well, I think talking about highlights of drives and what we've had, so Viam and I were just discussing our highlights, and both of us agreed most definitely the elephants in infrared. That was absolutely spectacular, and not only because we could see them, but that vocalizing that they were making was so intense and so incredible. It really was a special sighting, and like I say, the atmosphere of that is you're sitting in the pitch black, so while you guys are seeing a beautiful bright image of an elephant, what we're seeing is absolute darkness. We don't see anything, there is nothing, so all you're doing is relying on your hearing to pick up all these sounds and to sort of determine what's going on around you is really quite something. So that is definitely one of my most special elephant sightings that I've had since I've been at Safari Live. It was really, really quite cool. And to see that massive male elephant in amongst it and breaking that branch, so, so, so incredible to see. So that is my highlight of the drive, Shelley. I don't know what Byron's would be. Maybe Byron's would also be the elephants that he had on foot. Sounded like a very cool sighting. Oh, we've got a little scrub hare in the road. Hello, little scrub hare. I don't want to blind our scrub hare, so I'm just going to turn the lights down at least. There we go. Sorry, it's a bit dark, isn't it? There we go, that's a bit better. Now we can go into infrared, and I can turn off my lights completely. There we go. Isn't that cool? So now we are complete darkness, and we're not affecting that scrub hare in any way now, so we can actually watch it for a little bit. Now, these little hares are out a lot at night. This is a fully grown adult, so quite a big one. And we know that it's a hare because of those very upright ears that it's got. A rabbit often folds its ears down against its body. It's also the hares come out at night more than they do during the day, whereas rabbits are more diurnal. And then you see they've got very long legs. Rabbits tend to have much shorter legs and hop around and are not as agile as what the scrub hares are. The scrub hares are very, very fast and agile little creatures. So quite nice to see them in the dark. Right, we're going to just try and see if we can get past this little scrub here and not affect it too much and see if it will just go off the road for us. The best thing to do is often just to shine into the bush so that they can see that there's no danger there, and then they'll just duck off that way. There we go. There's a nice way for you to go. Come on, little scrub here. Now, I wonder if we've maybe got the scrub here that Taylor had the other day. No, go that way. Ah, the scrub here is going the wrong way. It's not the best way to go. I was hoping it would go to the left. Right, so it's coming to that time. We unfortunately are going to be finishing the show now. So it's been an absolute pleasure having you with us this afternoon. I hope that you've enjoyed it. It's been quite special to spend so much time with all the big, large pachyderms that we did this afternoon. So it's been really, really good. And so from Byron and Craig and Jandre, Taylor, myself and Viam, it's, like I say, been a great pleasure, and we will see you all tomorrow on our sunrise safari, and we'll be out at 5:30 as per normal, and hopefully it's going to be a good start to the morning and that the royals will be back. We've got no sign of the royals at this stage, so hopefully they'll be back and be around.